Penguin Random House Audio presents Why We Don't Suck and How All of Us Need to Stop Being Such Partisan Little Bitches. This is the author, Dr. Denis Leary. There's no room for demons when you're self-possessed. Carrie Fisher. Warning. They have something called sensitive readers now. Publishers hire them to comb through each page of a new manuscript looking for words, phrases, and ideas that are currently deemed politically incorrect and therefore capable of upsetting their delicate lives. Two of them were placed under medical care while trying to finish this book. Author's note. Every fact in this book was Googled and double Googled, then Googled again, except for the facts that came from my voluminous but sometimes cloudy collection of memories. If you don't believe they happened, you can kiss my Irish ass. This is how I remember them happening. Some names have been changed to protect the innocent, although I don't know why, because in the end, just like me, they are all guilty. I should also remind you that I'm a doctor, a real doctor, of arts and letters. I have the official diploma that says so hanging in my office. There's a photo of it in my first book. How did I become a doctor? I got famous. So my alma mater, Emerson College, from which I actually graduated in 1979, gave me an honorary doctorate many years later when I became a movie star. I made a very funny and extremely short speech, which the kids loved because they were graduating and wanted to go party their asses off. Emerson saved my life, first by giving me a scholarship, which was the only way I could ever afford to attend college, and then by virtue of its teachers, who created an atmosphere that allowed creative students in the arts to thrive. I also met my wife, Ann, there, and we are living happily ever after. Anyway, the point is, I'm a doctor, so I obviously know what the hell I'm talking about, and if I make fun of you in this book, it's for good reason. I also make fun of myself in here, a lot, like a fuck of a lot. So look at the bright side. We both deserve it. Plus, if you sue me, it'll just sell more copies of the book, and even more people will end up reading or listening to whatever it is that's got you in a snit. My prescription? Lighten up and laugh a little. And if you can't manage that, this is really gonna suck for you. Dedicated to my wife, Anne, who is everything. Let he who is without sin cast the first stone. I'm going to throw these fucking eggs. Denis Leary, 1971. Shortest opening chapter ever. I was sitting in the Miss Worcester Diner with my dad one day in 1965 when the guy behind the counter delivered my cheeseburger and said to him, "John, is there anything you can't do? Some guys who come in here say you're the best mechanic they've ever worked with. Other guys say as a carpenter and electrician, you could pretty much build your own house. On top of which, you play a great accordion, and I hear you were a great goddamn fast man on the Gaelic football field both over in Ireland and right around the corner here in Crompton Park. But if someone asked you to pick one thing and say that's what you are, how would you answer?" My dad looked up from his coffee and said, "An American." If you're going through hell, keep on going. Winston Churchill. Lead, follow, or get the fuck out of my way. General George S. Patton. Oh, say can you scream. Dear Hillary supporters, what happened? Michigan, Wisconsin, and Pennsylvania is what happened. Plus a server wiped so clean, it might as well have been a free ad for Bleach Bit. How much do bridal party yoga pants cost? Three fucking states. But look at the bright side. It wasn't the end of the world. Trump was victorious. And 1 year later, the sky hasn't fallen, the sun still rises, and Sheridan moved to Canada. Plus, Canada's not building a wall to keep us out. Yet. There will be no Trump-ageddon or Hillary apology tour. Dear Trump supporters, despite what your hero says, the press is not the enemy of the American people. The real enemy of the American people is butter and politicians who have no sense of humor. Too many of us have turned into chubby fast food junkies who can't take a fucking joke. The president is guilty on both counts. And no matter how many misspelled tweets and blabbermouth declarations he makes, there was no voter fraud or you just inauguration crowd ever seen. Period. And Trump won't be impeached for election ambiguities or for damaging the ozone with a massive carbon footprint comprised mostly of hairspray. It's very simple math. The House of Representatives can't agree on a catered lunch, never mind removing the president. Democrats moan, Republicans groan. Hillary speaks, the president tweets, leaving people like me to ask the really important questions, like, whatever happened to covfefe-flavored covfefe? American politics has always been a clown show, but our latest presidential circus finished as a 50-50 proposition that left this country divided right down the middle. Trump's hyper-patriotic motto, Make America Great Again, resonated with one half of the population. The rest bought into the ultra-bland Hillary for America. They both promised to bring back manufacturing jobs, which will all be done by robots within the next 7 years. And this clowniest of all clown shows ended with no clowning at all. Funny friends I love from both sides of the aisle have lost their minds and all attempts at humor as they rage tweet against Republicans or tweet brag at the Democrats in a nonstop series of social media insult bombs. Hillary and Trump are both infected by the unfunny flu. Now they're coming to get the rest of us, but not on my fucking watch. Hashtag make America laugh again. Fake news. Trump won in a landslide. Alternative fact, Hillary handed him a last-minute squeaker. Trump promised to drain the swamp. He didn't. He just filled it up to overflowing with rich friends and family members, just like Hillary would have done. And each tribe still drenches our electronic devices on a weekly basis, continuing the political turmoil with ridiculous partisan bullshit. Chelsea Clinton tries to tell Republicans at large that she doesn't care about money, after a $3 million wedding to a hedge fund founder. Eric Trump says Democrats aren't even people, unless they play golf on Trump-owned courses, I'm guessing. Because Eric's only real contribution to society so far is knowing the difference between a 9-iron and a lob wedge, and how much to charge you for using both. Hashtag make America golf again. Meanwhile, nothing gets done in D.C. They hold hearings to form committees, to figure out soundbites, to get book deals and fatter lobbying funds. They're not fighting for us. They're fighting for TV time and free filet mignon. And what are the actual voters doing? We're worried about Russian wiretaps on our Chinese phones while driving Japanese cars made in Mexico and sipping Guatemalan lattes topped off with Canadian milk. Hashtag make America anxious again. Trump puts a tanning bed in the Lincoln bedroom. Hillary gets paid for making speeches about why she isn't sleeping there. Well, I'm still trying to decipher exactly what her motto was supposed to mean. Hillary for America? She would have been better off with a more truthful approach. Hey, America, it's my fucking turn. Trump won with 306 Electoral College votes, finishing 45th out of the 58 presidential elections in American history. Now, most high-ranking civil servants would shy away from discussing such pedestrian results and humbly enter office, hoping to change people's minds with 4 years of positive bipartisan action. But not the Donald. He decided to ignore the math and manufacture fantasy figures about my amazing victory and my large electoral college numbers and the biggest mandate ever. Can you really trust this man when he says, I guarantee there's no problem regarding the size of his own penis? Forget Billy Bush and grab him by the pussy. Here's some real locker room talk, okay? Guys with big cocks don't boast about them. They're too busy fucking. Meanwhile, how insane is it that our most recent round of presidential debates devolved into a discussion about the girth and length of a male candidate's genitalia? Let me speak for every guy I know, from both ends of the political spectrum, when I say this in a very bipartisan voice. Ew. And let me publicly record the reaction of every woman I know from age 19 to 90. Ew! If we ever needed proof that it's time for a woman to lead this country, Marco Rubio and Donald Trump provided it live one night on national TV when they both acted like 14-year-old boys at a circle jerk. I'm surprised Carly Fiorina's head didn't explode. Can you imagine her beginning a debate by saying, the education budget is tight and so is my vagina? No. The only recorded instance of Carly discussing her breasts in public was to warn other women about early cancer detection. While Trump and Rubio aimed street corner crotch arrows at each other, Carly was focused on the real issues, whether you agreed with her or not. So clearly one would think much of America was primed for a smart, classy female voice speaking into its most powerful public microphone. And former Secretary of State Clinton seemed to have that bull by the horns. 2 weeks before November 8th, she held what looked like an insurmountable lead, part of which actually held up, because Hillary won the popularity portion of the contest by almost 3 million votes, which is probably how many emails she erased during the course of her campaign. If you're a Hillary fan or an extreme diehard liberal, stop listening to this book right now. It's only going to melt your lefty gossamer wings. Go listen to Elizabeth Warren's new book, I May Look Like Annette Bening, But I'm Really a Native American. It'll teach you how to pay higher taxes while quoting Rosa Parks. If you're a Trump fan or an...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.